We've spent a lot of time talking about the gas phase. We talked about the gas phase for a whole chapter. In this chapter, we've talked about liquids. We've talked about going between the solid and liquid and the gas phase. We need spend a little bit of time focusing in on solids. We're going to focus on the crystalline solid. Remember, you've got the crystalline solid and the amorphous solids. There's not a whole lot we can say in this class about amorphous solids. There's just not any nice organization to them. But I want to talk about solids, and there's various fundamental types of solids that you need to be aware of. And really, this is all wrapped around something called a lattice point, okay? So let's say that this represents my solid, okay? We know that we have, as a crystalline solid, we have very regular repeating pattern. And this is going off in three dimensions. So this is maybe the face of the cube, and it's going back into, you know, distances back here. So that is a crystalline solid where we have this very definite repeating pattern. Each one of these little points that I am drawing here, we're going to call a lattice point. You're going to hear me refer to them as lattice points. A lattice point is just what gets repeated, okay, and what we see sitting at those spots. And at these lattice points, we can have atoms, we can have ions, and we can have entire molecules sitting there, getting repeated in this nice crystalline solid. So solids, these crystalline solids, can get categorized into various categories depending upon what is sitting at those lattice points. So let's work our way through each one of them. And depending upon what's sitting at each one of those lattice points and what's holding them together so that they stay in the solid phase, will give it certain properties. Properties of melting point. We'll be able to make claims about their melting points, whether they should be low or high. We can talk about them conducting electricity, whether they should or should not, all dependent upon what sits at these lattice points. Okay, so let's start with the molecular solid. The molecular solid at these lattice points are going to be molecules. Obviously, that gets its name. They're held together. So if this point, excuse me, if this point is a molecule and this is a molecule, what is holding them together? Well, what's holding them together are our intermolecular forces. So we started this whole chapter talking about intermolecular forces. And we know that intermolecular forces are fairly weak compared to bonds. So that's what's holding them together. And this is going to make them melt at low temperatures. It doesn't take a whole lot of thermal energy to break that attraction and turn this into the liquid phase so that it can slide by each other. So that is a very important property of molecular solids. If we look at a formula, we might be able to, just by looking at the formula, know that it is a molecular solid. It's made up of a molecule. It's not made up of atoms. It's not made up of ions. But we're going to see that there's another type of solid that's not a molecular solid that is got made up of a compound. So we'll see the difference here in a little bit. The next type of solid is an ionic solid. So what's happening in an ionic solid? Well, we have ions at the lattice points. So we've got maybe a sodium ion, and I'll draw it out here. Na plus here, and Cl minus here, and Na plus here, and Cl minus here. And so we've got ions at those lattice points. Now, the attractions are strong between a cation and an anion. It is not a weak intermolecular attraction. It is a strong ionic bond that is holding these guys together. So it takes a high temperature to melt them. They're going to melt at very high temperatures. But they are quite brittle. It is easy to break them apart. And I have just recently realized why that is. If I were to come up here and push down, let's do it from the bottom so you can see my hand. If I was going to come along here with, let's say, a little chisel, and I want to hit this substance and knock this up a little bit. If I were to knock it up a little bit by putting pressure here. I'm going to put the sodium next to the sodium and the chlorine next to the chlorine, and they're going to repel each other and they pop apart very easily. So they're quite brittle because it's easy to push them, shove them just enough to where this gets in the pattern. How far do you have to shove it? These things are tiny. You barely have to do anything to move that sodium to where it's aligned with this sodium, and poop, it pops right apart. So they're highly brittle. But it does take a high temperature to break the ionic bond with thermal energy. So if we were just given descriptions of the substance, and we only had these two to divide between, we could say, hey, this one melts low, this one melts high. We can easily put it into one of those two categories. What else we can say about ionic solids that is not up there is ionic solids, if you were to melt them, okay, so they have a very high melting point, but you can get them to melt. In the molten phase, okay, liquid, they will conduct electricity. Why? The reason they will conduct electricity is because to conduct electricity, you have to have a mobility of ions. Ions have got to be able to move. We could have solutions with ions in them that will conduct electricity, but you can take the molten phase because the ions can move past each other. It's in the liquid phase, after all, and it will conduct electricity. All right. The next category is atomic solid. So I told you that we could have at each one of these lattice points, and I think I will remove all my little sodiums. So I've got a sodium and a chlorine, and get rid of the word ionic bond there, and put my lattice points back. Okay, so I have a lattice point here and here and here and here. So I've talked about molecules for the molecular solids. I've talked about ions for the ionic solids. The last one is each one of these lattice points is an atom. Now, each one of these lattice points is an atom and not an ion or a molecule, then we would give the category of atomic solid. Now, atomic solids can be divided into three additional categories. Now, not all textbooks will do that and give us these as a subcategory of atomic solid, but I really like the way that is because it all defines what's at those lattice points. So let's look at what we can have. We could have the idea of a non-bonding atomic solid. So we have an atom here, and an atom here, and an atom here, and they're not bonded to each other. They're just being held together, in this case, by weak van der Waals forces, okay? Weak attractions, not bonds. Okay, so if we had these weak attractions, they would melt very easily. This is going to happen when you take something like a noble gas. Let's say we take argon and turn it into solid. You can get solid argon. So if you're getting solid argon, we know we're forming attractions, but these attractions are weak. It takes a very, very, very low temperature to get it to get into the solid state. You barely raise it up, it's going to melt pretty readily. So that's an atom that's not bonded to that one with a covalent or an ionic bond. It is just being attracted by these weak dispersion force attractions. All right, so that is your lowest one. There's going to have no good strong attraction between them. The next one is called a metallic solid. So what are each one of these lattice points? This is a metal, this is a metal, this is a metal. So this could be all the same metal. Let's say it's gold, a gold atom, a gold atom, a gold atom, all through there. Or it could be bronze, and it's a mixture of metals, but each one of these lattice points is still a metal. So that's a metallic solid. We could take mercury. Now we know mercury is a liquid at room temperature, but you can lower the temperature and you can solidify it, okay? So it could be a mercury atom, a mercury atom, and a mercury atom. Now these things tend to be very dense, but they melt at a wide range of temperatures. We cannot pigeonhole it into the category of being a metal solid by knowing its melting point. We have mercury, which melts below room temperature. There's some metals that are solid, but as soon as you put it on, the warmth of your hand would melt right there on your hand. And then you've got tungsten. Tungsten is the highest melting metal, and that's what makes a filament in a light bulb incandescent light bulb that are going out of style right now, you know, that's made out of tungsten. It heats up very, very hot, but does not melt in the process, has a very, very high temperature. So it has a wide range of temperatures, but each point is a metal. It's really easy to know that you have a metal if they give you the formula, because they say, okay, I've got iron. What kind of solid is it? Well, that's a metal, so it's a metallic solid. Not too hard to understand that. Now, what else can we say about these metallic solids? Oh, got to back up. Something about them conducting electricity. A metallic solid will conduct electricity. Electricity in the solid state. Okay? Now, the reason that it can conduct electricity in the solid state is because of the way they bond together. I'm going to mention this a little bit here. All right, so we're going to get rid of the term weak attractions. What happens in a metal is the valence shell, okay, the valence shell of electrons are overlapping their space. Overlapping the space. So I'm drawing the valence shell. Maybe this is lithium, and the valence shell is an electron in a 2s orbital. So there's electrons in this 2s orbital, and they're overlapping their space. And we just have a big full space where the electron that was in the valence shell of this atom doesn't associate itself with this atom anymore. It can travel anywhere in the space whatsoever. The electron that's the valence electron associated with this atom won't stay associated with this atom. It can travel anywhere in there. We call this a sea of electrons. Okay? That is what allows for the conduction of electricity. If we were to hook this up to a battery, for example, and allow electrons to come in, they can come in and take the place of the electron that chose to be here. We're just going to move on down the line and move on down the line. And if we have a wire coming out, that extra electron is just going to mind its way on down there. So that is metallic bonding. It's not a covalent bond, sharing of electrons. It is not an ionic bond, an attraction by ions, opposite charges attracting. It is a metallic bond formed by the overlap of these valence electron shells and allows for a really non-directional, where those electrons are, I'll just say it that way, the valence electrons can move about in this sea, allowing for it to conduct electricity very easily in the solid state. So while we cannot label something as a metallic solid by saying, hey, this guy melts at a low temperature or this guy melts at a high temperature, we can either know it by its formula, that's easy, or we can say in the solid phase, this thing conducts electricity, and only the metallic solids are going to do that in the solid state. Those ionic ones only conduct if they're in the liquid state. And we have one last one, which sometimes is hard to figure out. It's really not, but we have to know what information to look at. Covalent network solids have, and we're going to draw, since I've ruined that picture up there, I'm going to draw my little lattice points here. Each lattice point is an atom because we're talking about subcategories of atomic solids. So each one of these is an atom, but those atoms are being held together by true covalent bonds, so sharing of electrons. So between the two atoms is a covalent bond. So if we want to melt this guy, we have to add enough heat to break a covalent bond. That is not easy to do. So these have very high temperatures when they melt. Now, when you look at their formula, you might have a hard time knowing whether this thing is a molecular solid or a covalent network solid. Sometimes they're just called covalent solids because the formula doesn't give it away. They're both compounds. How do I know whether it is a molecular solid or it's a covalent solid? The only way you're going to know is to know something about its melting point. Silicon dioxide, this is one of its crystalline structures, is quartz. Okay, so you have a silicon that is bonded directly to two oxygens. And then this silicon is bonded directly to two oxygens. Okay, that was the one for this guy, but this has got two associated with it. And it just keeps going off in all directions and forms a pretty crystal. But every bond within there is a covalent bond, and you got to break those to have it happen. Carbon in the form of diamond is another covalent network solid, where it has exactly the same structure as what I was kind of going off in here, but everything is a carbon. Carbons are covalently bonded to other carbons, and it goes off in all directions in a nice crystalline structure. So that would be a covalent network solid. Diamond has the highest melting point of all elements, okay, because to melt it, you are breaking all of those covalent bonds in there. So that is the summary, and I've got a slide that actually gives us kind of a breakdown of all this that I have borrowed from a previous textbook from the author Tro. But it's a nice visual image of a summary of all of those things that we have gone through. So we see the molecular solid with an example of ice. We see an ionic solid, which is an example of table salt or sodium chloride. And we see solid xenon, gold, the metallic solid, and quartz. I was telling you about the solid, the silicon dioxide, that's quartz, and that gives you the conditions of each one of those solids.